Hello everyone and welcome to today's webinar about data management in the hatchery. My name is Gert De Lange and I'm Senior Poultry Specialist at Royal Pastry Farm. It is great to be speaking with all of you today. Before we start the webinar, I would like to say a few important things about this presentation and about the platform that we use for this webinar. There will be three polls during the webinar and you are invited to give your opinion for which you will have a few seconds, about maximum 30 seconds. Of course, you will have questions during the webinar and you are invited to ask those questions by making use of the chat function. And we will try to answer your questions also during the webinar by the same chat function. And last but not least, at the end of the webinar, you will receive an email with the webinar replay as well as the handout of the presentation. So I think we are ready to start, so let's do so. Data collection in the hatchery. In a hatchery, we produce a lot of day-old chicks. Of course, that's our main objective. But besides that, also a lot of data is being generated. And in this webinar, I will deal with these data, how to record these data in such a way that you can also utilize them for analysis. Data that we collect in the hatchery, we can divide in data that we collect like every hatch again and again and again. It's common that people record flock ID and the age and the breed. Also the egg age is most of the time known either by the production date itself or by the arrival date in the hatchery. We know the setting date and the hatching date and of course the numbers like egg set, the clears, the chicks, they are all known, and dead in shell, later I will also show it in an example, is often calculated. These numbers and these data are known of every hatch. Then we have also data which are being collected continuous. For example, the climate from the setter and the hatcher histories for every cycle is constantly being recorded nowadays by computer systems. And the same goes for external climate, but also the climate in the clean air plenums, including temperature, humidity, pressure, and the exhaust plenums, the pressure is a very important factor there. These things are continuously being recorded. Then there is data that we collect more on a sample basis, so less frequent. For example, egg quality reports, or a chick quality report, or a breakout report. It's very rarely that in a hatchery, every hatch, all the batches that you produce on a specific day, a breakout is being done. This might be done once in the 2 weeks, once in a month, for example. Also, eggshell temperatures and egg weight loss, it's not something that is constantly done in most hatcheries, but on a sample basis, this might happen. And then, of course, there is also external data. Data that you receive from the breeder farm or from the farm where the chicks are going to, like first week mortality, but also transport conditions of eggs, of chick or chicks from the breeder farm or to your customer is sometimes being recorded by data loggers, and all this data is also part of the data that is being collected in the hatchery. We get a lot of numbers like eggs set, eggs removed during kennelling, perhaps even different categories if the kennelling machine is able to differentiate between early mortality and late mortality and true infertile eggs. And then sellable chicks. Sometimes most of the hatcheries don't, but I prefer myself very much that people also count the cull chicks. Those numbers are being collected, but numbers in itself do not make too much sense. They are used to make calculations to come from numbers to percentages, like hatchability, fertility, hatch or fertile, and dead in shell percentages. And this brings me to the first poll. And it's about hatch or fertile. I would like to know from you if you agree or not agree with the fact that with the statement that I'm making, that hatch or fertile can only be calculated in one way. So basically there is no need to discuss about how to calculate. Do you agree with this or not agree? Please let me know by answering the poll question. And in the next few slides, you will see that I will discuss about how to calculate hatchery fertile. Two hatcheries might not necessarily mean the same when they compare who has the highest hatchery fertile. So hatchery calculations, we are making a lot of these calculations, but the question is, can we rely on these calculations? Do we speak all the same language while we are calculating? I will show you a few examples to make clear that it is very important that you at least understand how you calculate. And we start very simple. We start with an example whereby we set 100x and this results in first class chicks, sellable chicks, 86, but there is one cull chick, so the total chicks is 87. How do we calculate hatch of XZ? Well, we can follow method A, whereby we only count the sellable chicks, and that brings us to a hatch of XZ of 86%. But you could also calculate hatch of XZ by counting the total chicks, and then we get 87%. Both ways are correct, but when we talk to each other, it's important to understand how is the calculation actually done. Most commonly, people are calculating hatch of XZ based on the sellable chicks. We go to the second example, and this is about hatch of fertile, the same hatch of fertile as I was asking about in the poll. We start with 100x, and during candling, 9 clears are being removed. So when we calculate hatch of fertile, we have 86 sellable chicks divided by 100x minus the 9 clears, and this brings us to a hatch of fertile of 94.5%. And you might now say, yes, I agree, this calculation is done correctly. But what if we do a breakout on these 9 clears? We see that in the breakout, out of these 9 clears, 5x are true and fertile, and the other 4 are dead embryos. So if we want to calculate hatch of fertile in the correct way, the hatch of true fertile, we are not losing 9x out of the 100x set on infertility, but we are only losing 5. So the hatch of true fertile is 90.5%. You see, two different ways of calculating. In fact, method A is not hatch of fertile, if you take it literally, but it is hatch of X transferred, HOT percentage. Often, this is called hatch of fertile. So, two different ways of calculating, and we still talk about the same 86 chicks out of 100X. So, which method is correct? Well, it doesn't matter which one you use, but you have to realize how you calculate and how you should interpret. If we continue with hatch of transferred, method A, we candle and we find 9 clears, but what if the candling accuracy is better? If your candling machine is doing a little bit a better job, or your candling operational team is finding one extra egg, then you will see that your hatch of transfer automatically goes up from 94.5% to 95.5%. The production results did not change. We still have 86 chicks out of 100x set, but just by more accurate candling, your figures are changing. We go to the third example, dead in shell. We have 100x set. Now, nobody is going to count in real practice how many eggs did not hatch. It is often a calculation. So if you start with 100x set and you remove 15 eggs during candling, and then you still have 74 chicks and one cull chick, let's assume that the cull chicks are also being counted, then you remain with 10x, which is not accounted for. And these 10x, we call them dead in shell, and in this example, it is 10%. In practice, when people talk about dead in shell, we think about mortality after transfer, late embryo mortality. But in this example, these 10 dead in shell eggs are being opened by a breakout procedure. And what do we see? 5 of these 10 dead in shell is actually a clear egg that has not been recognized during candling. And 1 is a mid-embryo mortality, which of course in standard candling procedures based on light could skip through, but only four of them is really what we consider late embryo mortality and which is often thought of as dead in shell. So is dead in shell 10% or is it only 4%? You see, dead in shell itself, we can discuss about what does it actually mean. How accurate is your candling? And then a final example of calculating. We see here a data sheet from a specific hatch day on the 10th of July 2021 with three flocks, three different flock ages, different numbers of eggs set. And we see that flock A, for example, has 6% clears, flock B 5% clears, and flock C has 10% clears. Now, what is the average percentage of clears on this specific hatch date? There are two ways of calculating. We can, of course, just take the average of 6 plus 5 plus 10, bringing us to an average of 7%. But we can also work with the totals, with the red numbers. In total, 1,000 eggs were set. In total, 63 eggs were clear. And it brings us to an average percentage of clears of 6.3%, much lower than the yellow figures. And that is because, look to flock B. Flock B has the lowest percentage of clears. In the yellow numbers, it is given the same amount of weight when calculating the average. But if we look to the red numbers, 500 eggs, that's the biggest amount of eggs out of the three flocks that is being set. And those 500 eggs have a much heavier weight when we calculate in the red figure style. And the red figure style is actually mathematically more correctly than the yellow calculation. But again, how do hatcheries calculate? They might not follow the same rules. So in general, and the conclusions when we talk about are hatchery calculations reliable, be very careful when you compare with other hatcheries or when you compare with standards. First, make sure that you understand exactly how you calculate, the method that you follow, and also the method that, for example, the other hatchery is following with whom you want to compare. Also check for calculation errors. Check the input. If you put a comma on the wrong place, or if you put one zero too much, for example, then you might get very funny calculations with hatchabilities over 100%, for example. It's important that you understand the values and the logic of the outcome of your calculations. And if you're not sure about it, it's better to use a blank than to guess and to put a figure which you fantasize. Okay, now about recording and storing these data. Why actually do we collect data in a hatchery? Well, often this is done to report to the management, like a daily report, a daily hatch report, a weekly summary, a monthly report, etc. This is a very common way why people do data recording in a hatchery. Also for quality control. Take, for example, the quality control of the incoming eggs from a breeder farm. Yeah, you record data, and if you see that a certain farm has too many second-class eggs, dirty eggs, or micro-cracked eggs, you can contact the breeder farm to see how you could solve that issue. Also for troubleshooting and for later reference in case of issues, for example, high first week mortality in the farm, you could refer back to your data, for example, climate graph of the setter and the hatcher, to see if something went wrong there. Another important reason for collecting data is continuous improvement. You always want to do better. And what you want to do is to see trends over time in production. How was last year's hatchability compared to this year? Or when you want to compare with standards, or when you want to compare the different breeder flocks with each other, or different hatcheries, or different incubation programs, or even when you want to see, are all the setters and all the hatches giving the same outcome, or is one setter constantly underperforming? And if you have a question, for example, what is the effect of egg age on my hatchability, then you need data which you could analyze. An example of continuous improvement you see here. You see a graph with the gray bar showing the overall hatchery average of hatchability for the different flock ages. And then with the red bar and with the yellow bar, you see two different farms, the results, the hatchabilities of two different breeder farms. And clearly you can see that farm one, the red bars, are always lower, or not always, but most of the time, lower than the overall average. Whereas the yellow farm, farm two, is doing better. So if you want to improve your hatchability, there is no need to spend time and energy to visit farm two and to give advice how to improve breeder farm management, but farm one definitely can improve. I would like to do another poll, and that is, in this case, I would like to know, how do you finally record or store your hatchery data? I have to explain the word finally. You might start on paper, but from paper you might go to put the data in a computer system. I want to know your final way of recording. Do you start on paper and everything stays on paper? Or do you work with spreadsheets? With spreadsheets and then daily totals and daily averages is being recorded all the time. Or do you work with a relational data table without daily totals and without daily averages? Probably the question is a little bit difficult to understand. I hope later on, when I explain what is a relational data table, you will understand exactly. And it is very important to understand that the method you store your data determines how easy you can use these for further analysis. You could store your data on paper. As you can see here, an example from a Korean hatchery. The question is now, if you store data on paper only, and this is just one paper, but what if you have one paper per hatch day and put them in files like this? Is that easy to analyze? Well, I think the answer is not surprising. No, it is not. It even happens to me sometimes that I visit a hatchery and I get an entire book like this and they ask me to make my conclusion. It is almost impossible. You have to flip from one paper to the other and you never reach to a good overview. It is much better when you put data in a computer system in spreadsheets. But if you look to this example, this is a breakout done by a farm, and you see on the left side, you see a breakout form of a flock of 29 weeks old. On the right side, you see the same breakout form, and now for a flock of 38 weeks. Still, it is not too easy to analyze if you have separate spreadsheets. You need to combine these spreadsheets to one table if you want to do a proper analysis. Here we see an example which we see a lot in practice. This is a batch report. A batch means, in this case, a daily hatch report. It's good for daily reporting, but not for analysis. I know it's difficult to see. I will zoom in a little bit and make it a bit bigger. And I show you that this batch report is starting with a block telling you the setting date, the kennelling date, and the hatch date. And every new batch will start again like this. And every day, this was hatch day 20 May 2021, you see that the daily totals of this specific hatch date are given below. So there are really calculations being made of totals and averages. And another issue that you see here in this batch report, which I think does not make this batch report complete, we only know the flock ID. R1 is the supplying breeder flock, but there is no information, for example, about the flock age. So if you want to do analysis, this batch report is not really being helpful. Also, the batch reports that we generate in Smart Center Pro, our computer system, they are good for daily reporting, not for analysis. But this data is very useful when you put it in a proper way in a relational data table, which I will explain in the next tutorial. And I use a very simple example how you can go from a batch report in a spreadsheet to a way of recording that you can easily analyze. If we look to this example here, we see in the first line, the dark gray line on top of the table, that these eggs are being incubated in setter 12 on an incubation program with the name EV2, and this belongs to the hatch date of the 10th of July. And below we see the different figures for flock A, B and C, and finally we see the total and the averages being calculated. This same form you can put like this in Excel, for example, as a spreadsheet. And this is for hatch date the 10th of July. And then 1 week later you have another hatch the 17th of July, and you simply add your next batch report below. But again, this is two different tables and it's very difficult to make an analysis on it. So what can we do? How can we create from this daily report a nice relational data table that allows us to make proper analysis? You see that I marked setter and I marked it green, and the program I marked it orange, and the hatch date I marked it blue, simply to show you that when you take away these data from the heading of the table and you enter it into columns, just like you enter flock and age and number of eggs set and number of clears in columns, you are creating a relational data table. And I have entered the data from the daily report now in a relational data table for just for the 10th of July. But when I have next week my next hatch, I simply add the data below it. And when 1 week later, on the 24th of July, I have new data again, probably even with a different incubation program, in this case test, I simply continue with this data table forever and ever. And now I can very easily make analysis. For example, by making use of the pivot table function in Excel. You simply select the data that you want to analyze, and you click on pivot tables, you open a new worksheet, and in no time flat you can create graphs like you see here. Now, I understand that this graph is not very impressive because I used the example from the previous slides. So you see flock A with two hatch dates, you see flock B with two hatch dates, and flock C, 58 and 59 weeks, remember, 10th of July, 17th of July, so the flock is getting 1 week older. But you can understand, when I continue working with this relational data table for a year, I get very nice lines. Now, sounds quite easy the way I say it. Of course, if you're not familiar with pivot tables, you need to spend some time to make yourself familiar, but it is not all that hard. So in summary, the way I have seen it in practice, it was in a hatchery in Korea. This is Korean language, as you see here. They started the records on paper, but they entered it in a computer in the proper way, in a relational data table. So just a continuous data table, like I have explained. And with that, they were able to make all kinds of graphs, again, by making use of pivot tables. In this case, you see an example of the hatchability by flock age for four different setter programs. And clearly here you can see that the blue lines are outperforming all the other lines. So it looks like incubation, the blue incubation program, is giving the best hatchabilities for all the flock ages. This is coming from a relational data table which is collected like every hatch again. The next graph is from breakout results by flock age. And this is done on a sample basis, and this might be a complete different relational data table. What you see here in this graph is that the orange bars, which represents the membrane mortality, so before the blood ring, is actually the biggest reason for embryo mortality. But if you want to ask a question, do flocks with the lowest hatchability, that's the first relational data table, indeed have the highest membrane mortality, that's another relational data table, you need to link those two relational data tables together. And that makes it a little bit more complicated. So I would like to know if you have people in your company who are able to link different data tables together for a deeper analysis. I'm kind of curious to find out if you have people in your company who can do that. And you might not have people yourself, you might even ask external specialists, data analysts to help you with that. In the next slides, I will show you how Royal Pass Reform could offer assistance for this. We are currently working on a project which is called data warehousing, and what we do is we collect data together with customers from, for example, the Smart Center Pro, but also Excel sheets from their ERP system. We are working on an app for entering breakout results and for PASCA score, etc. And this is many, many data sources which we can connect together. And of course, all these data become only interesting when you report them. So there is a reporting tool with dashboards with customer-specific possibilities. And we can also help you to interpret these data and to propose improvements. You see here an example of different kind of relational data tables which are all linked together. And just an example, you see here a hatchability by flock and by age. Many, many different lines, many, many different flocks, and you can easily see which flock is doing better than the other. And you can see on the dashboard that the average hatchability in this hatchery is 84.76% in the period that we analyze. And the next one shows you how we can combine different data tables. For example, the first graph on top shows you 7-day mortality in relation to the average outside temperature, the average outside daily temperature. And you see clearly that during the colder months of the year, the first week mortality in the farm is higher than in the summer period. And in the graph below, you see the same temperature line, but now in relation to hatchability. I hope I have made you aware that when you put data in a proper way in a data table, it is more easy to analyze. We do have a white paper for that on our website, which is called Efficient Data Management in the Hatchery. And probably the part I explained about using pivot tables went very, very quickly. We also have a tutorial on YouTube which shows you step by step how to use pivot tables to analyze your hatchery data. And this brings me to the end of this webinar, and I would like to thank you very much for watching. A few minutes from now, well, let's say an hour from now, you will have an email with the webinar replay and the handout, and you are warmly invited also to visit our knowledge section at our website. Hope to see you next time. Thank you very much.
Royal Pass Reform, for the highest number of best quality chicks.